The next case to be argued is American Claims Management, Inc. versus Allied World Surplus Lines Insurance. And this case is number 20-56053. I'm reading it correctly. Oh, 56055. And for the appellant, we have Ms. Angela Dunning, and she'll start off. And for the defendant counterclaimant, appellee, we have Mr. Paul Hughes. So we thank you both for appearing remotely. And it's a big help to us during this trying time of pandemic.
Before you start, Ms. Dunning and Mr. Hughes, and without any charging of your time, I'm confused by the day sheet, which refers to an option two. Can you explain to me if that has any meaning to you? And if so, what option one was?
Your Honor, it has no meaning to appellant, I'm afraid.
How about you, Mr. Hughes?
No, Your Honor, that does not have meaning to me. My apologies.
I'm getting a waving of a hand from the courtroom deputy saying what?
That has to do with the tech side of everything. So it's either to do with how they join nurses, Zoom, or how they join Teams, or how they join another way.
Oh, I see. It has to do with the presentation, whether it's in court or whether it's... by Zoom. Okay, pardon me, I just was curious about option two. Please start, Ms. Dunning.
Thank you, Your Honor, and may it please the court, Angela Dunning for Appellant ACM, American Claims Management. I'll try to reserve 4 minutes for rebuttal. The district court's order granting summary judgment against plaintiff ACM and in favor of its insured Allied World should be reversed. In finding that two exclusions bar coverage and therefore any liability by Allied for bad faith, the district court violated basic rules of contract construction, disregarded well-settled California law requiring that exclusions in insurance policies be interpreted narrowly with all ambiguities resolved in favor of coverage, and flouted fundamental summary judgment principles by repeatedly resolving genuine issues of fact in favor of Allied, the moving party. The court also misapplied the law and engaged in improper fact-finding in dismissing American Claims Management's duty to defend claim. None of the claims was properly resolved at summary judgment, much less in favor of Allied. Before diving into the two exclusions at issue, I'd like to briefly explain how we got here. As a third-party administrator, or TPA, ACM adjusts claims made against insurance policies issued by its insurer clients. This case centers around ACM's rights as an insured. It bought a professional liability policy from Allied to protect it in the event it was accused of mishandling claims for its insurer clients. The policy covers any professional services wrongful act, which is defined to include any actual or alleged negligent act, omission, misstatement, misleading statement, or breach of duty by ACM. The whole purpose of the policy was to protect ACM against exposure for mishandling claims, and specifically for failing to settle within policy limits, which the record shows is the biggest exposure TPAs face and the number one reason ACM purchased the policy. The policy also imposes on Allied a duty to defend any claim covered in whole or in part. That duty entails a right to control the defense, which Allied exercised here, including the right to negotiate and settle on behalf of ACM as Allied deems appropriate. ACM filed this case because when its client, QBE, accused it of negligently failing to settle an automobile claim within policy limits, Allied appointed counsel for ACM who, at Allied's direction and for Allied's benefit, pursued a disastrous defense strategy that converted a very defensible claim for both QBE and ACM into a losing one, and then refused to cover the increased liability that caused for its insured. That is, allied in the defense counsel it appointed and controlled, orchestrated and created the very liability Allied now refuses in bad faith to indemnify. Material issues of fact precluded any finding at summary judgment that the bad faith and fraud exclusions bar coverage, or that Allied's appointment and control of defense counsel did not violate the duty to defend. This court should reverse and remand so that ACM can present its bad faith and duty to defend claims to a jury. I'll start with the bad faith exclusion in endorsement 9. The district court misinterpreted this exclusion as a matter of law. The bad faith exclusion bars coverage for claims arising out of actual or alleged lack of good faith in handling claims arising under an insurance policy, but only if there has been an actual determination or admission of bad faith. Specifically, endorsement 9 states that the applicability of the bad faith exclusion, quote, may be determined by an admission, final adjudication, or a finding, unquote, in the underlying claim or a collateral proceeding. The district court essentially ignored this language and held that a mere allegation of bad faith is sufficient to bar coverage under the exclusion. That was plain error for at least three reasons. First, the court cited and then flouted the most basic rules of contract construction, that contracts be construed in accordance with their plain language, giving effect to every provision and avoiding an interpretation that renders any language superfluous or absurd. If a mere allegation of bad faith were sufficient, as the district court held, the language specifying that the bad faith exclusion is triggered by an actual admission or finding would be rendered mere surplusage. The court's construction is also absurd on its face. The concept of an admission, final adjudication, or a finding of an allegation makes no sense. Second, Allied has admitted that a finding of bad faith, not merely an allegation, is required to trigger the exclusion.
I have a problem, Ms. Dunning. I've had a problem with this case, and perhaps you can help me with it. It seems to me that the claim handling by ACM and failing to promptly respond to the demand by the Cardona plaintiffs was effective to blow the limitation, the $30,000 limitation, much before anybody at ACM started lying to QBE. So that it was the failure, as the arbitrator said, unintentionally is a very important word here, because unintentionally seems to say to me negligently, that the policy limits were already blown by negligent action of ACM before any of the folks at ACM started lying in bad faith to QBE about what had happened. If that is so, right, why aren't you covered?
Your Honor, so I absolutely agree that there is coverage. We, of course, don't agree that there was any lying or intentional dishonesty or bad faith here, and there certainly has not been a finding of that. But Your Honor is absolutely right. The arbitration panel found, and this is at ER 347, the panel found that ACM's, and I'm quoting, failure to timely review the demand letter, timely respond thereto, and ultimately pay policy limits, quote, unintentionally removed the lid, unquote, on QBE's $30,000 policy limit, exposing QBE to bad faith liability. It ultimately paid $15 million to settle. It also found that QBE's attorney's fees were incurred as, quote, the direct result of ACM's failure to resolve the claim within policy limits, unquote. All of this happened in the first few days when the Cardona sent a demand requiring that it be responded to in 15 days, and ACM negligently failed to respond.
All right, so but then we go beyond that. I see the arbitration decision as saying that ACM then started lying to QBE and continued lying, but was QBE aware of the lies? when it could have settled for $1.8 million in the mediation in 2014?
So, Your Honor, one clarification, which I think is important, is the arbitration panel never found that ACM lied. The arbitration panel never found that there was intentional dishonesty. In fact, they credited and they were impressed with the credibility of the ACM employee who documented the final and refused to find that he did anything intentionally wrongful. They were certainly critical, but there was no finding of bad faith. There was no finding of intentional dishonesty. And so, yes, by September of 2011, years before the settlement was reached or any liability was found, QBE was aware that ACM had missed the deadline. And this is in the arbitration decision, that this had come out very early on. And so it cannot be the cause of any, it cannot have contributed to or brought about any liability here. And the arbitration panel did not so find. And what's so critical about that, Your Honor, is that both for the bad faith exception and the fraud exception, the bad faith exclusion and the fraud exclusion, there has to actually be a finding in the case of the bad faith exclusion that ACM engaged in bad faith conduct. There is no finding. And on the fraud exclusion, there has to be a finding not only that ACM engaged in fraud or intentional dishonesty, and Ally does not dispute intentional dishonesty is required, but there has to be a finding that that conduct contributed to or brought about the liability.
I'm more concerned with the cause element than I am with the fraud or the bad faith element. My reading of the case is that the real desiderata here is whether QBE knew that it had been lied to by ACM as to the receipt and handling of that demand letter. If it did know that the ACM had been in bad faith or fraudulently falsifying the record, then it should have been able to engage in settlement at a much earlier point.
So, Your Honor, again, there's no finding that anyone at ACM lied or engaged in any intentional misconduct, intentional dishonesty. But I agree with Your Honor. QBE was well aware of the fact that the deadline was missed, and had that information when it engaged in settlement discussion for years before it agreed to pay out any amount under the policy and settlement of the claim.
Well, that's not exactly
further,
what
the arbitration panel refused to award punitive damages. And rejected.
You say QBE was well aware the deadline was blown at an early point, and certainly by September 2011.
Yes.
But that's not exactly what Mr. Sanuti's opinion letter said. I thought that Sanuti was an expert who looked at it. QBE determined that it was unlikely that the policy limits had been opened up. And this is 2012. Now, if QBE well knew the deadline was blown by 2011, why is your expert saying that QBE determined that it was unlikely that the policy limits have been opened up?
That opinion was based on the fact that there was no bad faith in the missing of the deadline. When the Cardonas sent their unilateral demand that their settlement, their policy limit settlement demand be accepted within 15 days, the fact that ACM was unable to ascertain that had come in and respond to it in time didn't in and of itself give rise to any sort of bad faith claim or
is that
negligent failure to respond. And in fact,
is that because Cardona's gave too short a period of time to accept the settlement offer?
Their firm was well known, Your Honor, for playing these tricks where they give the short amount of time and then claim later on that that the deadline is blown and therefore the policy limits are no longer applicable. So by the time anybody was engaging with the Cardonas at QBE, QBE was well aware that ACM had missed the deadline.
Okay.
I'm happy to continue to talk about this. There were a few other points that I wanted to reach and haven't had a chance to do in light of the timing. Briefly, and then I'll try to reserve what time I can for rebuttal. With respect to the bad faith exclusion, again, and the fraud exclusion, any ambiguity has to be interpreted in favor of coverage and against Ally. The district court did exactly the opposite. It conferred every interpretive inference and benefit in favor of Allied and against coverage. With respect to the duty to defend claim, there are the record is replete with issues of fact going to whether Allied controlled the attorney it appointed for ACM and whether and approved and endorsed and directed the conduct that has as a result led to the liability we're facing here, and those issues should not have been resolved at summary judgment either. The district court applied the wrong standard in looking to Borrello, which applies only in the employee-employee context and has been explicitly limited outside of other agency contexts, and didn't even identify the factors from Borrello that he believed justified excusing Allied for responsibility for its appointed counsel's conduct. So with that, Your Honor, I will try to reserve the remaining time for rebuttal. Thank you.
Counsel, for your planning purposes, we'll give you 2 minutes for rebuttal.
Thank
we'll
you, Your
add
Honor.
To your time. Now we'll hear from Mr. Hughes.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Your Honor, and may it please the court. Paul Hughes for Allied World Surplus Lines. If I may, Your Honor, I'd just like to jump directly to the dishonest act issue and to pick up on Judge Bea's questioning as to the causation issues. I think the district court rested on multiple independent grounds in finding that there were dishonest acts here that contributed to the claim. As I think the court's questioning suggested, there was a long course of conduct that the arbitration panel found where ACM failed to provide necessary information to QBE. And I'd like to come back and explain in detail the various parts.
The way I see this case, it has two different sections or eras, right? ACM blows the deadline because of the I don't know how to classify it other than negligent actions of their appointee, Eisen. And that, to my way of thinking, opens up the limitation or blows the limits right there. And then the bad faith, the lying about what had happened, is not directed toward the plaintiff, Cardona, but is directed toward the insured QBE. So the bad faith that I see has no causative effect in blowing the limits and removing the $30,000 limitation. Am I seeing a different case?
No, Your Honor, and let me help explain that, because I think there is some confusion and I hope I can help clear that up. I think the court is certainly correct in understanding that there was dishonest conduct with respect between ACM and QBE after what the court described as negligent. And we might not agree that it's negligent, but I appreciate the court's opinion with respect to that. But here's where the court found that later conduct, that failure to provide QBE information, directly contributed to this underlying claim in excess of $18 million.
I have trouble hearing what you're saying. Why don't you pick up the microphone and put it closer to your face? Right.
Yes, Your Honor. Is this better?
Hello.
Now, you're going to tell me how the bad faith denial of receipt of the letter, when they said we didn't receive any letter, how that contributed to blowing the policy limits from 30,000 to none.
Your Honor, what I would like to focus on, if this I believe is responsive to the court's question, is why the dishonest conduct of ACM not providing information as to its own underlying conduct, QBE, caused the full $18 plus million of the claim that's at issue here.
I can't hear you all that well. Please, I don't know what's wrong with you, but just hold up the microphone to your voice, to your mouth. Try again. Tell me.
Is this better, Your Honor? I can try alternative technology if you're still having trouble. Is this okay? Yeah. Okay, thank you, Your Honor. So to turn to, there are three parts of the arbitral panel's award that I think are critical to answering the court's question. The first begins at record page 342. And here's the quote from record 342. ACM, quote, concealed information that QBE would have needed to independently assess its risk and protect itself from extra contractual liability to its insurer. Again, that's record page 342. And what the panel is saying is because QBE did not provide the information, ACM did not provide the information to QBE, they could not accurately assess that. The second point, and this goes to the court's questioning of ACM earlier, is the passage that relates to the Sanuti coverage opinion. This is at record page 338. And the
332?
338, Your Honor. 338.
All right.
And what the court says at page 338 is that, quote, Sanuti's timeline demonstrates his ignorance of critically important facts known to ACM by then. And what the panel continued to say was that because Sanuti did not have this information, what was provided was, quote unquote, inadequate and misleading. That prevented QBE from making knowing determinations as to how to limit its liability. The third point of the panel's decision to which I would point the court, again, is at record page 338.
Well, wait a minute. Let's stop right there. Regardless the timeline of Mr. Sanuti, if you indulge my conclusion that the limits were blown when the March 11th, 2011 date passed and the policy limits offer had not been accepted. Whatever QBE did not know because of the bad faith of ACM could only have helped them not to prevent losing the limitations. The limitations were already lost, but it would help QBE in settling at a figure lower than $15 million. Is that your point?
That's precisely my point, Your Honor, is that there is a wide chasm between the $30,000 limits and the more than $18 million that the claim is at issue here. And we know that because we see in the record that there was extensive settlement discussion. This is described at pages 333 to 334. For example, at one point, a $1.8 million offer was made. And I believe the record suggests that there was other settlement opportunities that were possible. And so the entire $18 plus million claim that is being asserted here was contributed to, the arbitral panel expressly found, by virtue of ACM not providing timely, accurate information to QBE so QBE could mitigate its damages in an appropriate manner. That's the crucial harm here, Your Honor, is the dishonest acts precluded timely, appropriate mitigation of damages through what could have been an earlier settlement.
If that's your point, Mr. Hughes, then I suppose the remedy would be to reduce or to provide insurance coverage above the amount which QBE could have settled for.
I'm not sure that's correct, Your Honor. I think the exclusion is written more broadly, such that if the dishonest acts contributed to the claim in part, that could bar coverage. Although I take Your Honor's point that I suppose there could be an alternative way. I don't believe that's an argument that to date ACM has pressed for a more mitigated form of damages. And again, bear in mind, this litigation arose because Allied World had expended the entirety of the $5 million policy. It was ACM being dissatisfied with the payment of the entire $5 million policy, where they assert extra policy claims against Allied World that has led to this litigation in the first place. Now, I'll also point out, Your Honor, there are additional dishonest acts that contributed to the claim. And that includes the dishonest acts of ACM in the context of the arbitration itself. The arbitral panel was clear that it said, quote, egregious that ACM has repeatedly tried to conceal and misrepresent the fact of timely receipt of the letter demand from the Cardonas. And what the panel said was that this dishonest conduct, quote, considerably undermined ACM's credibility. Further, at record page 345, the panel called ACM's conduct, quote unquote, reprehensible in its efforts to, quote unquote, sandbag QBE as to the issue as to whether or not QBE was a volunteer when it reached a settlement, the $15 million settlement with the Cardonas. And I think the evidence is in the arbitral panel that this too contributed to the full award of the claim that the panel issued here. Because again, much of the panel's decision was making credibility determination after credibility determination. And the panel said, in no small part, that ACM had destroyed, undermined its credibility based on what it identified as dishonest conduct in the course of the arbitration, which we also think contributed to the arbitral panel awarding the maximum amount it could have on the claims here. And so, for example, where the arbitral panel was called upon to make credibility determinations, at record page 344, Ms. Patel, the president of ACM, claimed that there was no reference to the demand letter in the file on March 29th. The panel, in a credibility determination, flatly rejected this claim. The panel said, quote, it agrees that ACM did not provide complete claim file information to QBE. The second reference at record page 345, Ms. Patel disputed whether Sando Cardono mentioned the demand letter on his March 8th, 2011 call. Again, the panel resolved this factual dispute against ACM as a credibility matter and said, quote, this is critical information that should have been promptly disclosed. So, Your Honor, we think the two different prongs of dishonest conduct. First, the dishonest conduct in failing to timely provide information that QBE needed in order to mitigate damages. That was directly found by the arbitral panel. And the arbitral panel said that this concealment of information undermined QBE's ability to, quote unquote, protect itself from extra contractual liability. That is the direct nexus between the dishonest acts and the nature of the claim. And then the additional nexus is found from the dishonesty in the arbitral panel and its nexus with the ultimate claim that was identified by the court. I'll pause there just to, if the court has further questions. I want to make sure, I know that was an issue of the court's focus.
I have a question, if I can answer it, if you can answer it for me. I'm a little concerned about Mr. Jample. The assertion is that he was controlled by Allied World. What's your response to that?
Thank you, Your Honor. So a few things. As a legal matter, the level of control is that which is drawn, we think the district court appropriately found, from the employment context, to say the individual has to be controlled to the extent of where an independent contractor would stop being an independent contractor and would become an effective employee of the insurance company. That's what the California court in Merritt said. It has to be that level of control that the individual stops being an independent contractor and becomes a functional employee of Allied World.
Well, both parties were talking to him, right?
Yes, Your Honor. And let me say, Allied World had control over the ultimate defense. But there is a significant distinction that the district court appropriately drew between control of the defense and control of the lawyer who generally serves as an independent contractor. Mm-hmm. And let me just provide an example that might help illustrate that. If I hire a painter to paint my house, that's a typical independent contractor. I can control the painter and telling the painter, I'd like to paint the living room green and the kitchen blue. That's control over what the painter ultimately does, but that does not render the painter no longer an independent contractor and my employee. It just means I am directing the ultimate outcome as well as some of the things the painter will do. The question is, does this rise under California law standards to make Mr. Jampol an effective employee of Allied World? That's the analysis that the California courts in Merritt give us. And Merritt says, no, you're not going to hit the standard when an individual has their own independent law office and they engage in the general practice of law. That's kind of conduct that there's no factual dispute. There's no material, genuine factual dispute as to whether Mr. Jampol had effectively become an employee of Allied World. Mm-hmm. That's the kind of evidence they would need. And to the contrary, the evidence here is Mr. Schrainer, the general counsel of ACM, is the one who was principally directing all of the decisions. The testimony was clear that he was getting his quote-unquote marching orders from Mr. Schrainer, and that Allied World was giving very little direction. And to the extent that there was any day-to-day direction, it was on the part of ACM, not on the part of Allied World. But to your court's ultimate question, the district court was absolutely correct in saying there's nothing, there are no facts here that could possibly give rise to a disputed material fact as to whether Mr. Jampol should be treated as the employee of Allied World.
So the other question of Mr. Jampol was whether or not he was competent at the time of hiring. When I was trying these lawsuits a half a century ago, there weren't many people around that did nothing but these kinds of cases. As a matter of fact, most lawyers are running from them. Why? I'm not sure. What is your position on him as being a competent person in this area of expertise?
Thank you, Your Honor. And if I may go over my time,
you can answer the
question, Your Honor. Of course, yes, Your Honor. Yes, Your Honor. Your Honor, the issue of whether he was competent, of course, is assessed at the outset, the time of appointment. The California courts tell us that because after appointment, it converts to a malpractice claim. And I think there's robust evidence, and there's no way there could be a factual dispute on that based on ACM's own admissions. So Ms. Patel, the president of ACM, was asked their deposition, and I'll quote from this question. Was it your view that Mr. Jampol was a competent attorney in April of 2015? Answer, yes, it was. That's the supplemental record at page 169. In our brief, we cite additional things along these lines, but there is concessions by ACM that at the time of his appointment, Mr. Jampol was competent, and the district court identified a litany of undisputed record evidence about Mr. Jampol's successes in trial litigation, the several cases he had taken to trial, his experience in complex insurance cases, including those involving bad faith. Mm-hmm. So he had the expertise. There was no factual dispute about that. And ACM, in fact, conceded that at the time of appointment, they understood him to be competent.
Finally, as I understand it, this is all California law that applies here, correct?
Yes, Your Honor. And the California court's decisions, we think, are quite clear and instructive as to the standards that have to be satisfied and why Mr. Jampol...
I didn't find anything in the California law cited by either side that would force us into asking our colleagues in the California Supreme Court of what their law is. It seems to be relatively clear.
I think that's correct, Your Honor. I don't think there's any real material dispute of law, especially as it relates to Mr. Jampol and the duty to defend allegations. I think it is truly a question of did the district court correctly assess the summary judgment record and find that there was no material disputed question of fact, and we submit the district court was plainly correct in its assessment of the record.
So plaintiff here just would stand in the intersection on Broadway and decide they're going to go on one side to the state court or go on the other side of Broadway to the federal court, and they chose the federal court. That's about it, isn't it?
Yes, Your Honor. Happy to answer any other questions the court may have. Thank you.
Yeah, I have no questions. I think we have your argument in mind. We appreciate your argument, Mr. Hughes. Ms. Dunning, we're permitting you some rebuttal time.
Thank you, Your Honor. To readdress Judge Bea's point, I'd like to refer the court to ER 333, which lays out very clearly that the demand from the Cardonas came in February. By March 28th, QBE through ACM had offered policy limits to the Cardonas. They refused it on the grounds that the 15-day deadline they had arbitrarily set had been missed. We offered policy limits within the 45 days required under California law. Then at 333,
I didn't catch what you said, Ms. Dunning. You said we offered the policy limits within a period of California law?
Yes, in our briefing, Your Honor, we cite the California regulation providing that a settlement demand should be responded to within 45 days, and that's what ACM met. The arbitration panel also notes at page 333 of the record that by September 13th, QBE was, quote, by now aware of the true sequence of events. And then I'd like to just make sure the court understands that by this point, the Cardonas had not even filed a lawsuit. It wasn't until more than a year after these events that they filed suit, that there was any further discussion or possibility for settlement. And by then, QBE was fully aware of all of the facts at issue. They cannot have played any role in blowing the lid on the policy. And in fact, the arbitration panel at page 347 explicitly finds that the liability was due to failure to respond to that demand, a negligence, and not anything else. The panel also dismissed the bad faith claim and refused to find punitive damages. And so there is no finding that any bad faith or intentionally dishonest conduct occurred, much less that it caused the liability. The one important point on that that I want to direct your honors to, that the arbitration panel actually found that the suit against QBE became, and I'm quoting, became virtually unwinnable, unquote. This is at 343 of the record. Once the judge found that the assignment scheme that the attorney allied appointed and controlled, Mr. Jampol, when that went south and backfired, that is what converted, this is the arbitration panel's finding, that is what converted the claim from a defensible one in terms of whether QBE and ACM acted in appropriately to one that was very difficult to win. And that is why QBE decided to settle for $15 million. And of course, that $15 million was then passed on to ACM under the negligence finding at page 347 of the record. With respect to, so there was never a finding to trigger either exclusion, and the district court resolved numerous factual issues and ignored the law requiring that ambiguities there be resolved in favor of coverage. With respect to the control issue, Travelers and Weber describe a much different standard. Just does the insurer have the ability to control the manner by which the attorney carries out the activities assigned to it? Borrello has never been imposed in this context. The district court didn't even assess which factors might support a finding that Mr. Jampol was an independent contractor as opposed to one controlled by the carrier. And Merritt is a 1970s case that predates all of the subsequent California law, acknowledging the really difficult situation and the reality that the loyalty of a counsel is often to the carrier and not to the insured it's appointed to defend. And Mr. Jampol, his firm acknowledged their loyalty was to Allied. He was communicating with Allied behind ACM's back, and he could not take any step without Allied's approval. That's all in the record from Mr. Jampol's deposition testimony. And then finally, I just have to address the comment that Ms. Patel at ACM somehow admitted Mr. Jampol's competence. Her testimony, and we pointed this out in reply, was that ACM assumed that he was competent because Allied was selected him and appointed him. And there was never an admission that he was competent. He did not have the skills that one would expect of one performing these tasks. And his background and experience was not even vetted by Mr. Arruda before he was selected.
Counsel, I think
there are factual issues on each of the issues.
Counsel, let me interject, please. You're several minutes over your already extended time. So please try to bring your argument to a close.
Thank you, Your Honor. I appreciate it very much. In summation, the district court resolved numerous factual issues, made findings. Even Mr. Hughes' argument said the district court found dishonest acts. The district court was not authorized to do that at summary judgment, where there are genuine disputed issues as to whether either of these exclusions apply, and certainly whether Allied should be responsible for the liability it and its controlled counsel helped bring about. So on that, we would ask that the entire decision be reversed and remanded. And thank you very much.
Thank you, counsel. Well, I want to congratulate counsel on both sides of the case for excellent advocacy on a difficult case. American Claims Management versus Allied World Surplus Lines shall now be submitted, and the advocates will hear from the panel in due course. And with that, the court will take a recess for 15 minutes before our next scheduled argument in EDC versus BOEM.